In the next hour, I will show you, give you sort of like collage-like lecture of my hybrid practice. I will show many projects, but it, in different media, different perspectives. But there will be one underlying theme, one argument I want to make, which is that the way we see nature today is very naive. It's about to change. Much of what we think of as nature is in fact a simulation of nature, not nature at all. And at the same time, a next nature is occurring in a place where we least expect it. Before I get into this lecture, I want to start with a short movie that I think is, well, at least for me, it's fascinating, inspiring, and also a little bit frightening. Here it is. This is a short movie about a copy-paste bird.
He clears a space in the forest to serve as his concert platform. To persuade females to come close and admire his plumes, he sings the most complex song he can manage. And he does that by copying the songs of all the other birds he hears around him, such as the kookaburra. It's a very convincing impersonation. Even the original is fooled. He can imitate the calls of at least 20 different species. He also, in his attempt to outsing his rivals, incorporates other sounds that he hears in the forest. That was a camera shutter. And again. And now a camera with a motor drive. And that's a car alarm. And now the sounds of foresters and their chainsaws working nearby.
So this is the copy-paste bird, and I assure you that this is not media art. This is an actual bird that exists. Now I start with the official part of the lecture. Hello. I am Koert. I'm an artist, I'm a scientist, I'm a designer, I'm an engineer, I'm a philosopher. I'm also a producer, a doctor, a blogger. So I guess in the end I am an amateur. In the sense that I do things for the love of it. By the way, I'm also a user, a consumer, an employee, a manager, a producer, and an animal. I think at least the last part is also important to emphasize. And I also want to emphasize that I like to boogie. And this is actually the most difficult part of the lecture. I don't mind if there's no light here, but... Okay, that's enough. I also like systems, people, media, reality. I like also reality and technology, culture, and of course, nature. I already told you I am an amateur. Well, certainly as an artist or as a painter, I'm an amateur. This is one of the paintings I made. I had seen these paintings by Mr. Bob Ross, American painter, on television. And I also tried to make these kind of beautiful natural paintings, but then when I did it, something strange happened in the wilderness. As a designer, I often design speculative products. This is a product I designed for the Coca-Cola company, Organic Coke. It's not on the market yet, but the day it will be on the market, we know we have reached the summit of a certain development that is going on. I also make installations. This is an example of an installation that I made. This is the data fountain. What we see here, we see stock traders looking at their fountains, which is really representing their money. These fountains are through an internet connection, connected to the stock exchange, in this case the currency rates exchange, and every 5 seconds the latest currencies are taken from the internet and presented in these fountains. And obviously the stock traders are very happy with this. And this item was made by the Japanese television. Here they asked me to explain the idea for the fountain, but you don't understand Japanese. So skip that. But I do want to quickly explain it further, because I was looking on my computer screen and I saw there the weather report. And I thought, okay, what we have here is explicit weather data. But when I look out of the window, I also see what kind of weather it is, but that's much more implicit data. It's not as precise, but it's something that you feel around you the whole day. And these are two models of presenting information. Now, if we look at the financial market and you look in the computer screen, then you also have these explicit data. But when you look out of the window and you want to see how your money is doing, then there's no implicit data. So that's why people are spending so much time looking in their screens to see how their money is doing, because like it or not, for many people nowadays, it's much more important to see how their finances are than the weather. And so I decided to make this natural phenomenon that would present the financial data in a more natural way, which became the data fountain. These are some early prototypes. Here we're building the thing. Well, technology is not working. And then the end is the data fountain. So the idea was to rethink fountains as information displays. And still, my goal would be that every fountain in the end in the world would have something to say, because there are fountains everywhere and people like them, children like them. It's nice. But if you really look at them critically, then basically all these fountains are just standing there being decorative, but they don't have anything to say in the end. So I try to connect fountains to information. Maybe we could do it here in Iceland with geysers, connect them to the financial market. I don't know if this is, well, sort it out for yourself. I also made a plant, by the way. Well, same idea. This is a scenario where we do it with three suns. Well, I don't know how technical you all are, but this would still be very difficult to implement, if not impossible. Yet, as a proposal, it's very valid. You can think of how we translate our natural environment into a media environment, and I'm interested in that. I will show you more in this domain later. First, I want to talk about another project that I did recently, and actually this is still ongoing, which is the Nano Supermarket project. Who in the audience has heard of nanotechnology? Quite many people, yeah. So people know that there exists something that's called nanotechnology, and most people also know that nanotechnology is about something very small. And this is true, because nano is 1/1,000,000,000 of a meter, and nanotechnology is all technology that takes place on this very small scale. And you're really operating then at the level of atoms and molecules, and you have different opportunities, different phenomena, and that's a whole wide field in which scientists are working now. And most people have heard of it. We know it's small, but I think that's not enough, because the big question should be, how does this emerging technology change our lives? So I felt it's time for a nano debate, and I'm not the only one, because in fact there is a nanotechnology debate going on in the world. People are thinking of what is the meaning of nanotechnology. And this debate is going on television, on the internet, in magazines, in science cafes. But I decided to take this debate to another location, which was the supermarket. Marije also already spoke about the supermarket earlier. And I think I have a similar feeling. I'm just very fascinated by the phenomenon of a supermarket. It's super interesting. On the one hand, it's a very mundane, everyday place. We all go there on a weekly basis, and we find it even boring, that we don't realize how advanced it really is. Just imagine that you would take a caveman, put him in a time machine, and then put him in the supermarket around the corner. He would probably not understand one bit of what he would see there. Packaged meat, non-fat, light products, powder milk, a pregnancy test. For a caveman, or even someone who lived 400 years ago, this would all be very unrealistic and one big science fiction. But to us, it's everyday life, it's normal. And we just live in this world. So basically the supermarket is the best evidence that we are living in the future already. And the supermarket also functions, I think, as a reality machine, where new habits, lifestyles, and technologies become part of everyday life. So hence it is the perfect spot to have a discussion about nanotechnology. I wanted to do that, so with some colleagues, I started building a nano supermarket. This actually is the logo of our supermarket. Well, we had different versions. This was the cheap one, I think. But in the end, we decided to go for this black and white style because it had to be supermarket noir. Our nano supermarket would be a place where we would present future nanotechnology products, but not only the ones that are inspiring and life-improving and uplifting, but also the technologies that are maybe a little bit dark, dangerous, or uncanny. And we made a mobile store. We were actually inspired by these mobile stores that drove around in the Netherlands in the 70s, long time ago. You had mobile supermarkets there. This is very retro and nostalgic. So we combined this with very something futuristic, and then we had our nano supermarket, and this supermarket now drives actually through Europe. We've already been in Spain, and we're going to the Salone Mobile in Milan in a few weeks. And everywhere we go, we place this bus, and then we spread around this flyer. And this is spread just amidst all the other supermarket material that you have, so all the advertising stuff. And people just find this flyer and they see, oh, there's a new supermarket in my neighborhood. And then they go to this bus and see that stuff inside the bus. And then they notice that it's actually an exhibition disguised as a supermarket. So what are our products? I will show you some of the products we have in there. A very popular product is the WallSmart Interactive Paint. It's a paint that you put on the wall only once, and then afterwards you can always change the color of the wall with your mobile phone. And this is based on magnetic nano rods that bend the light, so it has a technological foundation. Another product is the nano wine. It's a wine that can be any wine. It contains millions of nano capsules, and if you don't do anything with the wine, you can just drink it, and the nanocapsules, they're very small and they go through your body unnoticed. But if you put your glass of wine in the microwave only for a few seconds, because it's not the issue of heating the wine, but the issue of opening the nanocapsules, then you will alter the taste of the wine. So if you put it in the microwave 2 seconds, it's more like still a light Pinot Noir style. But if it's more like 5 or 6 seconds, you have more heavy wine like Shiraz. So then you can make the whole winery in one bottle. Some people love this, and some people obviously also think this is not what we want. But that's exactly our goal, to have this discussion. Another product is the pharmaceutical sushi. It's a sushi which already has the medicines inside. Yeah, because nowadays, especially elderly people, they take a lot of pills every day. Some people take 20 pills. They have this cocktail of pills that they take every day. And this is not a good quality of life. So can we perhaps put the medicine in the food, in this case in the sushi, and then you would have your personal sushi set, which is also your medicine. A product that most people find rather uncanny is the Twitter implant. The Twitter implant is implanted only once. You can do this at the dentist. And after that, it starts twittering everything that happens in your body. So if I go running, then it's being twittered. And then all my friends can see that I have a healthy lifestyle. But if I drink too much nano wine, obviously, this is also being twittered. And, well, the health insurance company that monitors my Twitter feed, they will probably give me some health penalty for that. Yeah, this is a direction most people don't want to go into, but now we know. A beautiful product that we have in the Nano Supermarkt is the Latro Algae Lamp. This is an eco-friendly lamp that is solar powered by a colony of algae. They are here in the lamp, and they gather the solar energy and transfer it to the light. It's still rather speculative, but I think it's also very, very beautiful. We also have in the supermarket the Nano Lift. Photoshop finally becomes physical. The idea of the Nano Lift, well, we present it as the best invention in the field of cosmetics since the lipstick. Because mind you, lipstick once, long time ago, was very artificial, not natural. You would not like it, whereas nowadays it's very accepted. Same might happen to NanoLift. It's very similar to Botox. You go to a clinic only once, and you get there your NanoLift injections, and then afterwards you have this handy stick which you can sculpt your face, only a little bit. You cannot change your face into Mickey Mouse. But if I go to a nice party and I want to have big, sexy lips, then I can do that with the Nano Lift stick. And the next day, I have a serious business meeting and I want to have a more modest look. So then I change it again with the Nano Lift stick. And I noticed that in the Netherlands, where we presented it, most people said, like, nah, this is not for me. But when we were in Spain with the Nano supermarket bus, there were lots of people who said, I want a Nano Lift. That's really peculiar. That's something I could not have predicted. And obviously, you can want the Nano Lift, but you cannot have it yet because, yeah, it's technically very difficult. This would, in the next 10 years, this will not be on the market. And maybe it will never be on the market. I want to make clear that with this project, we don't want to predict the future. I'm not interested in predicting the future. Rather, it's about building scenarios for potential futures that help us decide what technological futures we actually want. And although these scenarios are speculative, the debate that it facilitates is very real. Because people have a discussion about these technologies then. And one thing I want to say about the Nano Supermarkt project is that it's an ongoing project, and right now we have a design call out. So if there are designers in the audience, and I'm sure there are, and you want to think about new kind of Nano Supermarkt products that you want to get in the bus, there are flyers here. I put them here and you can take them. You can go to the website and you can send in your product and you can even win 2,000 euro. Which is, of course, not important, because the nice thing to win is if your product is realized in the bus, of course. I want to talk a little bit more about the whole tension between the artificial and the authentic, the tension between the fake and the real, and how the fake can become real at a certain moment. And I do this by talking about another project that I did some years ago, which was the fake for real memory game. I made a memory game. Yeah, I think everyone knows the whole concept of a memory game. You have two cards, and then on one card you see the Matterhorn in Switzerland, and then on the other card you see, no wait, this is the Matterhorn in Switzerland, and this is the bobsleigh attraction in Disneyland. That's an entertainment attraction in Disneyland that's presented as a fake Matterhorn. So obviously that is real and this is fake. That's very clear. But very often this becomes more confusing. Well, maybe here it's still clear, I don't know, but yeah, make no mistake, they do exist. Girls with a very tiny waist and very big breast. And they're very rare, maybe 1 in 1,000. But the problem that these women have nowadays is that nobody believes anymore that their breasts are natural. Because we're living in a society in which it has become so normal to go to a plastic surgeon and to get breast implants in order to look off, to look and resemble after the images you've seen in Photoshop magazines, that the natural breasts are not recognized as natural anymore. In this case, I have to say that they also aren't natural, but still. We cannot look at our environment anymore without referring to media experiences. This is an example. Well, every scuba diver that sees the real white, orange, striped clownfish, at least for 1 second you think, it's Nemo. You cannot suppress it. It's just, it's in your reference. It's in your framework. And sometimes the images become more powerful than the reality. I think it's happening here. That muddy, greasy burger that I have on my plate, that it doesn't look at all like the firm, delicious, nice burger that I picked from above the counter. And I remember when I was 8 years old, and it was sort of the first time that I went into a McDonald's, quite late, I think, because my parents weren't that fond of consumption culture. But of course, when I went into the McDonald's, I already knew everything. And I remember getting that burger, and yeah, it was a bit disappointing. It tasted good, but still I had the feeling that I was eating an image, consuming an image. That's happening nowadays. And often you cannot see what's fake and real anymore, because the real thing, well, you cannot beat the real thing, but then some generations like something else, whereas our generation now only drinks light cola and zero cola, so there's no real thing left anymore. And he was already mentioned, because you also see this in the world of design. This nice, beautiful chair has been designed by the Finnish designer, Alvaro Aalto. And here you see the Swedish interpretation. So this cost about $1,800 in a reproduction nowadays, and for $79 you can buy this Swedish interpretation, and you even get this extra stick to make it fully monkey proof. So this is the fake for real memory game, and I have one little story about it still, that I don't know if people recognize this pattern. It sort of resembles a French luxury brand, Louis Vuitton, because they make these expensive ugly bags, and actually, 90% of the bags that you see on the streets are fake. So if we are doing a project on fake and real, then that has to be in it. So we made the pattern sort of similar, like the Louis Vuitton bag. And we thought that was a nice joke, but they didn't. So there went the first edition. We got some letters from their lawyers. If you can't stand the joke, then we don't want you on our box anyhow. So there they went. Back to China. Toilet paper. And obviously we made a new design with Dolce Banana, Gucci, Chanel, Versace. And this worked. So a few more examples, because if you're talking about fake and real, then of course the most famous reproduction in the world has to be mentioned, the Mona Lisa, created by Leonardo da Vinci. And I would like to do a quick poll in the audience. Who thinks the right one is the real one, and who thinks the left? Let's first say the people who think the right one, and on top. That's, I think, less than half, but maybe some people are shy. So who thinks the left one? Now, sorry. I'm sorry to break your trance, but you know, actually, this is a projector. We are projecting these images here. We are not in the Louvre. They are both reproductions. And actually, there's one story about this Mona Lisa, because it was stolen a little over 100 years ago from the Louvre by an Italian guard who wanted to bring the painting back to Italy. It vanished for 3 years, then it was recovered, but there are some people who say that actually took them 3 years to make a very nice reproduction, which is now in the Louvre. I went there to check it out, to see if it's... to explore, but there were too many Japanese tourists standing around. I could not have a good look. And this might be a bit depressing story, especially if you bring, well, this example in it, Michael Jackson, the king of pop. On the left, we see him at the age of 50, after extensive plastic surgery, whereas on the right, we see an image created by a forensic artist. And an image was created in the computer, a visualization of what Michael would have looked at like at the age of 50 if he would never ever started doing plastic surgery at all. And obviously both images are in their own right virtual, because the right one is clearly a virtual computer image. But the left one is also virtual, it's only manipulated in the actual reality. So the real Michael, I don't know what he looks like in heaven, if he's there now. I don't know, we don't know. It's a bit depression, and now I really need my medicine, but Prozac, Viagra, candy, placebo, which exactly does not, what doesn't belong in the row? Where exactly lies the border between medical necessity or just taking drugs for entertainment? Both try to improve the quality of life, but what that quality of life exactly is, that's something that is to be debated by all. And the final image I want to show is, at least for myself, a very inspiring and also uplifting one. Because I have been showing these examples of extensive media manipulation, artificial things, simulations, virtual realities. But then what we see here is a walking leaf. So here we see a normal leaf. There's nothing going on there. But this here, that's the Phyllium giganticum. It's an insect that disguises itself as a leaf. This is his head, and this is the body. And I think this learns us something very important, which is that simulation, media, mimicry, it's all part of life and it's part of nature. And it makes us look differently and think differently about the situation we are in. And I have spent extensive amount of time on this to define it and to see what is going on. And this was my conclusion. Next, nature. It's a bit dark, I will read aloud. Nature changes along with us. Nature, in the sense of trees, plants, animals, atoms, or climate, is getting increasingly controlled and governed by man. It has turned into a cultural category. At the same time, products of culture, which used to be in control of man, tend to outgrow us and become autonomous. One could say the natural powers are shifting to another field. Hence, our established view of nature needs to be reconsidered, and we propose the term next nature for this culturally emerged nature. Next nature is real nature, not a representation or simulation of some long-lost phenomenon. Highways, airports, supermarkets, they're all part of our natural environment, and there may even come a moment that our connection with an industrially manufactured Coke bottle becomes more mythical than our relation with a genetically analyzed rabbit in the woods. Wild systems, genetic surprises, calm technology, autonomous machinery, I never make it. But I still have time left, so the remainder of the lecture I will spend on talking more about this next nature vision. And for me, an important moment was when I was walking in the dunes in the Netherlands and I saw there this strange tree sticking out amidst all the other trees. I went there with a friend and it turned out that this is not a tree, this is actually a cell phone antenna mast. Disguised as a tree. And why do we need this? I want to make sure, I want to make it clear, I don't think this is a good design. I mean, why? But it's interesting, because it tells us a few things. It learns us that we want to recreate the landscape and our environment according to our image of nature, that we, how we like to see nature, that's how we want to recreate it. So we don't want an ugly antenna mast in the woods. No, we want this fake tree, that we'd rather have the fake tree. But it also shows us something else, which is equally important. It shows us that technologies tend to become part of the fabric of everyday life, and very up to the level that we don't recognize them as technologies anymore. And we don't want to perceive them as technology, we just want it to work, and we want them to become invisible. We want to walk in the woods and still be able to use our cell phone. That's what we want. And I think it's clear that everyone here in the audience will agree that this tree, it's not nature. It's technology, it's culture. It's culturally made. At best, this is an image of nature, like a nice picture that you would hang above your sofa to look at a beautiful landscape. But here it's done, well, in a little bit more high resolution. So this shows us that much of what we talk about of nature is culture. Nature tends to become cultivated. And nature is also a very successful product. You can sell things with the word nature. Nature is perhaps the most successful product of our time. And here we gathered all the logos and brands that use references to existing animals in their visual communication. And there are really quite a lot. And I'm sure that not only in the Western world, young children, they know more of these logos and brands than actually birth or tree species. Like it or not, this is the situation we are in. This is our world. And many young children, they don't like chicken, but they love dinosaur. So if you would extrapolate this to the future, these dinosaur nuggets, and they would become more advanced. Marije already talked about the lab-grown meat, the in vitro meat, meat without an animal. Maybe we should go in that direction. I'm also working on that. Would this then be a future scenario, that you would have a nice dinosaur leg? That you could go in the supermarket and really free your inner caveman and buy a dinosaur leg or a saber-tooth fillet? I don't know. I don't think so. It's not what I propagate. And it's quite surrealistic. But then again, if you look at the meat of today, that's also, for me, equally surrealistic. If you look at this sausage, it's 100% made of animal, but the animal is 100% unrecognizable. It's very abstract and modernistic. So yeah, maybe creating, if this is the meat we consume, then we don't need the animal. Then we can also make the meat without the animal. Or maybe we can make it from beans, I don't know. There are some scenarios here. Well, this is a visualization. This is not exactly how it goes, but indeed, scientists are working on growing meat without the animal. This is the state of the art. Already a few years ago, a couple called Zuur en Katz, they made this first prototype. I must say, it tasted like shit. And it was very expensive. And we hope to have the first hamburger in the Netherlands by the end of the year. And it will cost, I think, 200,000 euros to make one hamburger. So it's not like we will be eating in vitro meat tomorrow. But still, for the future, it might go in that direction. And as we are thinking in that direction, we can also think about other things, like, for instance, growing organs. Again, a visualization. Scientists are working on tissue engineering, designing and growing organs, because there's a big shortage in organ donors. So maybe we can create them. And this is the state of the art. This is the first organ that was implanted. Piece of a throat. A piece of tissue engineered organ. And this is breaking a boundary, because if you look around you in the room we are in now, and you search for the most natural thing in that room, then there's some wood, but it's entirely cultivated. Maybe this water is also a candidate. But in the end, it's probably us, our human bodies. You are the most natural thing in this room, but that's also a border that's being crossed increasingly. So where will this go? I don't know. We can make visualizations. Ultimate fashion statement or female agony. Decide for yourself. But I want to say, don't worry, it is a Photoshop. But metaphorically, it's very true, because this shows, I think, an important story of our time, which is that the born and the made are now fusing. We are living in a time in which born things and made things are increasingly blending together. And born things, that's the whole domain of trees, animals, environment, climate, that was already there. Whereas made things, computers, mobile phones, they are increasingly fusing. And this is also why the whole relation between nature and culture becomes confusing, because everything that's born, that's sort of our framework for what we call nature, whereas everything that's made is culture. But as we are, as you've seen some examples that I've given, as you see that if we are fusing this these two things, then also our definitions of nature and culture become very blurry. Some people say, in the end, everything is just nature because man is part of nature and it's all, there's only existing nature. And others say, no, or everything is culture, because already when we start to talk about nature, we do this through our cultural lens. So our idea of nature is a cultural construction. That's sort of the postmodern view of looking at it. And both viewpoints, well, they have a case, but in my view, they don't solve it, because basically, if you deny the distinction between nature and culture, that's, from a philosophical perspective, it's not the best thing to do, because you basically deny the fact that people make this distinction already for a very long time and will probably continue to make this distinction, and you just say, you shouldn't do that. Rather, I argue that nature and culture are more like trading places. What used to be nature partly becomes culture, but also the other way around. So now I have this little graph, born versus made. That's one thing, but you can also look on the other axis and then put controlled versus beyond control. And the nice thing, if you have these four quadrants, then you can put all kinds of stuff in there, like, for instance, a rainbow tulip, a bonsai tree, a genetically modified banana, or a chicken. They are all born things, natural things, but they are in the human control to an extent that we hardly call them nature anymore. We drag them in the domain of culture. At the same time, there are still a lot of nature, born nature left, like viruses, volcanoes, lightning, and the sun, we don't have any control over the sun at all. It's so much bigger than us, and it's a born thing, and it's still a natural thing. There's no discussion there. There's no problem there. On the other side, if you look at made things, robo-dogs, cars, telephones, light bulb, made things that are also relatively in human control. Not that much tension there. But here is something else happening. If you look at traffic jams, the internet, computer viruses, or the financial system, perhaps the financial system is a very timely example of a man-made phenomenon that is growing beyond our control. Somehow we are unable to control it in the way we want. It's just, it's too complex, it's too difficult. And then it becomes, it has this other quality. So here on the left side, this is sort of like the old way of looking at nature versus culture, where you say this is nature, everything that's born. But now I think the new way of looking at nature is more looking at the things that grow beyond our control and define them as natural phenomenon, which in fact is in line with the Greek definition of nature, because the Roman definition of nature, natura, is very much related to born things, whereas for the Greek, the word psychis was dealt more about growth and independent growth, so growing beyond control. You could also look at nature in this way. So then in that quadrant, you have a new kind of nature occurring, the nature caused by people. That's what we call next nature. But it's not only when nature grows beyond our control. There are also other aspects, things that we notice in our own life, that are also, I think, very next natural phenomena. And an excellent example, because we were all there, is the mobile phone. I think most people here in the audience are still old enough to have lived in a world in which they didn't have a mobile phone, and the mobile phone was not this common thing. And at a certain moment, people around you started having a mobile phone, and maybe at first you said, I don't need a mobile phone, I don't want a mobile phone. But then one day you bought one, and today if you leave your house without your mobile phone, you notice, where's my mobile phone? And you quickly run back to your house to get your phone and to carry it with you. So it's not part of your body, it's not an implant, it's not about that, but it's very important for your life and your sense of identity. So you see how rapidly an alien technology can arrive in your life and then at a certain moment become really a part of your life that you don't want, it's hard to imagine life without it anymore. So yeah, you see this move from the artificial to something that becomes a second nature and maybe in the end could become a first nature and then it would be next nature. But with the mobile phone, I guess that hasn't happened yet. But it's a nice example because we were all there. Now imagine that I would have given this lecture 100 years ago. I would not have talked about mobile phones, but perhaps I would have talked about something else. Think of electric light. Little over 100 years ago, electric light was very new and people had to get used to it. Edison introduced it. At first it was introduced in hotel rooms and they had these little plates hanging in the hotel room, which said, this room is equipped with Edison electric light. Do not attempt to light with a match. Simply turn the key on the wall by the door. And I think the disclaimer is actually very interesting. The use of electricity for lighting is in no way harmful to health, nor does it affect the soundness of sleep. That's not something that we worry about. But 100 years ago, when it was introduced, people were worried about electric light and what it would do to their health and their sleeping habits. And in fact, it probably changed our sleeping habits, this artificial light. But we don't think of it anymore as technology or media. No, electric light is just there. That's not something we discuss. Now imagine I would have given this talk 10,000 years ago. Well, I would have not talked about mobile phones or electric light, but I might have talked about agriculture. I might have been this person talking about the radical innovation that agriculture brought into our lives. Because make no mistake, if we look at this image of these nice ladies today and they're planting their crops, then you would say, ah, this is nice, it looks like organic farming, it's in line with nature. But 10,000 years ago, farming, agriculture was a technological revolution which had a very big impact. People were roaming the savannah, gathering some food, doing a little bit of hunting, and then gradually agriculture, the notion of planting crops, waiting for them to grow, domesticating animals, keeping animals, was introduced and accepted. And this completely changed how we lived, because it allowed for different roles, different lifestyle. At a certain moment, someone would say, I'm now the mayor of this is a village, I'm the priest. Someone else would say, I'm the philosopher. And in fact, there are still researchers who say that since the introduction of agriculture, the human condition declined. That actually right today, our skeletons are weaker than before agriculture, and that we have more infectious diseases since agriculture. This is obviously very hard to check, if not impossible. And obviously there is also, I don't think there's a scenario in which we could say, let's get rid of agriculture and go back to the previous situation. As an individual, you could do it. You could today sell your car, your home, sell everything you have, use the money to buy a ticket to some location in the Amazon and start living a hunting, gathering life there. You could do it, but somehow it's not very tempting for most of us. Maybe as a recreational thing for a few weeks, it's nice, but to actually live like that, that's really something else. That's an example of a very old technology that was introduced a long time ago, and it really, at the beginning it was artificial and weird, and then it became second nature, and now it's just first nature to us. We don't experience this as technology anymore. One more example, if we would go even further back, we don't know exactly how far, but 200,000 years ago, cooking. If I show you this image of a barbecue, people will read this as a back to nature image, the habit of putting meat on the barbecue and cooking that meat, that's sort of like going back to nature. But 200,000 years ago, approximately, cooking was a radical new technology for mankind. For the first time, we started extending our stomach in the outer world, pre-digesting our food before we would eat it. And this also gave us time, it gave us more energy, easier food production, lots of change. So if we look at the whole history of technology, from Stone Axe to the invention of the fire, to agriculture, I already discussed, the invention of the wheel, writing, money, industrial revolution, and today we are living in the time of the bio, info, and nanotechnologies. These are the radical new technologies of our time. But if we put them all in a row, then you learn a few things. You learn that people are technological beings by nature. It is our natural tendency to create technology, and it's really not new. We do this all the time. We have a lot of experience with it. And if you look at it from a far distance, then basically we are continuously doing the same thing, which is we are playing with fire. And yeah, clearly playing with fire, it's something we do. It also makes us human. That doesn't mean you can just be very free about it and just do everything you want and that it doesn't matter. No, playing with fire should be done with, in a very concise way. And we have to be very precise about it. But it is something we do. So I think in the end, it's important to understand that nature changes along with us. And with every new technology we introduce, we also create a new setting, a new situation, a next nature. And this is what we do as human. We are sort of like catalysts of evolution. We create new natures and we cause the rising of a next nature. And it might be that this next nature is at least just as unpredictable as the older nature that we try to overcome with our technologies. So, and there's no end to it. It's the game we are in. Now, I try to share this different way of looking at nature with you, and I still like to show you some examples from my own life that I notice and that I just think like, how should I look at this? These are all the razors I used in my life. So I started with this very simple razor, two blades on one stick, and this morning I had a very pleasant shave with that six-bladed razor with a battery in it and a LED on it. And this is the whole, it looks a bit like a vacuum cleaner, I think. This is a whole process, and I look at it and I can't help but thinking, is this an evolutionary process? What is happening here? Because I see a lot of things happening that remind me of an evolutionary process. New models built upon previous editions. You have both functional changes, like more blades, but also aesthetic changes, only a different color, just to stand out in the shop. It reminds me a little bit of the exuberant feathers of a peacock. And you also see these systems of inclusion and exclusion, because they change the blade system every few years in order to keep out the competition. That's also a typical evolutionary process. So I would go in the direction and say, yes, it is an evolutionary process. But then most of the time people say, no, it's not evolutionary process because people are doing this. And that's right. We make this. And I'm not sure if we make this for our own comfort or if we make it to feed the Gillette Corporation that also wants to survive. But still, people make this. So at least it is a co-evolutionary situation. And this is perhaps the situation that we are in now. A co-evolutionary situation in which we co-evolve with our technologies. This is just a very small example. And that's not new, actually, because if you look at the flowers and the bees take the pollen out of the flower, they spread it, they gain nectar, they feed themselves, but they also spread the pollen so that the flowers can propagate. And the bees and the flowers also co-evolved. And I think we are now, with our technology and mankind, also in this co-evolutionary situation. And it's important, because if that's the conclusion, then we have to be very precise about that relation, and that it's also to our benefit, to the human benefit. When I walk in a shop, I see all the kinds of products, and I also wonder, is this biodiversity? People say biodiversity is decreasing. There are some facts about it, it's true. But something else is happening as well, and perhaps we should not call it biodiversity, rather technodiversity, but that seems to be increasing very rapidly. Right now, today, already on the planet, there are more patents filed than there are species known. So this is sort of a situation in which we have to keep a keen eye on the balance, I think, the balance between these two domains. When I look at the financial system, here represented with a flock of credit cards, I also wonder, should we look at the financial system as an ecosystem? If we do that, would it help us to avoid or at least soften these crises that are happening? And also, if we look at it as an ecosystem, what kind of ecosystem is it? How does it relate to other ecosystems, like the rainforest? How do they combine? These are all questions. And this image, I also think, is very Well, for me, it's very beautiful and inspiring. This is not some solar system far, far away. Closer than you think, this is a map of the internet. It's actually already a few years old. Every computer in the internet is a little dot, and all the connections between all these computers are plotted in this graph. And then this is what you get. And I look at it, I think it's beautiful, and I also think, wow, is this a natural phenomenon? And then it's created by us. Are we causing this natural phenomenon? And how do we relate to it? Because you're very small, you're just somewhere there. It's very insignificant, one would say. But then again, you are also connected. So that also means that you can make a difference. And that's helpful, I think, at least for myself. I try to dedicate what I do to exploring how we can live, build, and design in this next natural situation. And I don't have all the answers because it's too big, but I have some mantras already developed. Mantra number one is that we have to embrace complexity rather than always trying to simplify our reality in models. We have to face the fact that things are utterly complex and take the complexity for what it is. That's very different than the modernistic approach that we've seen in the 20th century. We should try to guide growth of these phenomena rather than gain total control over them. Because total control, well, if you look at the financial system, total control, these notions of control, they're not working. But perhaps we can guide the growth of next natural ecologies. We should focus on designing processes rather than products. And we are living in a time in which the made and the born are fusing. For many people, this is still very confusing and also a limit that they think we should not cross. But we already crossed this limit when we first domesticated an animal 10,000 years ago. We are doing this, we just have to think of how do we want to do it. And in order to do this right, I think we can still learn a lot from the older natures that we stem from and take them as a mentor. So learn from natural situations that we know and project them on the new situations that are ahead of us. And I think the most important thing in the end for us is to create a humane technology. A technology that takes human needs as a cornerstone of its development. A technology that resonates with our human senses rather than numbing them. A technology that feel natural rather than estranging. And technologies that may revive human intuitions. Maybe some intuitions we already forgot about for a long time. Technology that doesn't outsource but empower people. And technology that in the end not only improves the human condition, but may also realize the dreams people have of themselves. That is my desire, this is what I'm working on. And to wrap it up, I want to show one more project that I did, if I have time. I have time, thank you. Because recently I made a book about Next Nature, and I just like to show you the process and some of the things we did there. We started out with a blog. I think it's now 5 years ago, no, 7 years ago, I made a commitment to myself that every day I would blog an observation related to Next Nature. I started doing that, no visitors at all, no one was watching. Then after 1 year, I had 4 editors and some contributors. I had 250 observations and there were 1,000 visitors. That continued in 2008. More editors, more contributors, more posts, and 1 million visitors. And in 2010, it even grew further. So clearly there was this connection with other people. Blogging is just very free way of putting down observations. So we had developed all kinds of themes, topics, ways of looking in the blog, but it's just this stream of ideas and consciousness. And it's not very accessible at a certain moment. If you have 2,000 stories and you're on a website, you think, I would like some order. So we decided to do something very old-fashioned. which is made a book. We made a book, and this is it. Actually, it consists of seven magazines, and every magazine discusses one aspect of this next nature. The first edition is about the general introduction. Then we have a chapter about who determines how our image of nature is created. We have a chapter about wild systems, how we should embrace complexity, how we can deal with that. We have a chapter about the office garden, how we serve our systems as much as they serve us. A supermarket essay or a chapter should be in there, of course. And how can we look at our supermarket as our next savanna? There's also this uncanny chapter about anthropomorphobia, the fear about what's happening to humans in relation to their products, how products tend to become people, and people tend to become products. And finally, the Back to the Tribe chapter, which is about how new technologies are not only putting us at a distance from nature, but may also revive ancient intuitions and ancient natures through new technology. So that's the book. It's very visible. I just like to flip through some pages. There are essays and more like shorter observations. Well, I'm not going to discuss all the typologies. I'm going to skip something now, but there's one more thing I would like to share with you, because the nice thing if you make a book, well, we thought we're making a book, we're not making a movie, but still we are going to make a book trailer. Like normally you would make a movie trailer, and we made a book trailer. And this is it, this is our book trailer. Of course, there's this handy URL where you know how to get the book that you can do. But the most important thing, I think, is that it was a pleasure for me to share this next nature way of looking at things. I don't know how this will continue, but I am sure about one thing: is that as mankind is causing a next nature, at least we can be sure that in the end we will get the nature we deserve. Thank you.